Viva Decor's Maya Gold is a water-based paint that's full of shimmer and lovely color and is permanent on most surfaces. Today we'll experiment with this paint and a number of fun techniques that can be used on a variety of projects. Rather than start with a brush, I thought it would be fun to work with a brayer, and I'm going to use these three colors. I have fire red, magenta, and I believe this is aubergine. Yep, it is. So I have three warm colors that I'm going to work together with. Now, the one thing that's really nice about these paints is that they're beautifully thick and lush. So here is the aubergine, and you can see how dense the color is. It's full of glimmer, and this is not watery paint at all. I mean, it's very thick, and it provides really nice coverage, but it's not opaque, which means you can put layers on your piece and you're not going to necessarily obliterate what's underneath. Now you can with multiple layers, but obviously you don't have to. So let me get myself set up. I'm going to bring in, this is my Strathmore Art Journal. This is the soft cover with the 140-pound watercolor paper. And I think if I work back here, I'll put the paint out in the front and I'm just going to run the brayer through it. So I'm going to sort of smear a little bit of paint out here. I'm going to get it loaded up on the brayer, and then I'm just going to randomly apply some color here. I'm not looking for anything other than getting some color on here, but by turning the direction of the brayer, it allows me to change the shape or the pattern, if you will, of what I'm putting on. All right, so there is the aubergine, and I think that that's enough of that. Now, cleanup, like all water-based paints, is with water, so I don't necessarily have to clean in between, but I do want to show you how easy it is to clean this up. Now, I'm not going to get real fussy because I'll probably come back and mix these colors up anyway, but this is it. It's that simple. Now, the nice thing is that not every water-based paint is permanent. However, this one is. It is permanent on fabric also. I don't know how much you can wash and dry it, but I certainly put it on. Look at this paint. How fabulous is this? You can certainly put it on fabric. I've done that, and then I came back and I tried to scrub it off once it had dried, and there was no scrubbing it off, trust me. So again, I'm just going to get my brayer in here, get that loaded up, and I'm just going to come in and I'm going to put some layers on. Now you can see the aubergine through here still, which is really nice. We're not locked into one color. We can layer and get some really nice effects. Now obviously, I'm using a brayer. You're not limited to a brayer. You can certainly work with a brush if you want. Lots of different ways to utilize this. But sometimes, you know, I work with sprays a lot. It can be fun to come back and do something a little bit different. And just to be different, this time I'm going to bring in the fire red, and I'm actually going to put it right on top of the magenta that's still on my craft sheet. Now let me just clean this off a little bit because I don't want to mix the colors in the jar. Again, this is fire red. This is a more orangey red than the other two, but I think it's going to provide a really fun contrast. So I'm just going to smear some out on my craft sheet and then begin braying it through. Now you'll notice that I've got a bigger puddle here, and I'm just kind of rolling some of it off because I don't want a big blot of color. But again, cool things that you can do. You can create really dark, dramatic backgrounds if you want, or you can work with lighter colors, and that's something that we're going to take a look at too, is creating a wash of these. But you can see how easy it is to work with this paint and how wonderfully lush the colors are. I like products that are versatile, and these Maya Gold paints certainly are. One of the things that you can do is stamp with them, and I'm going to show you that with these three colors. I have violet, which is this beautifully rich, deep purple. This is called olive, but is really more of a teal color, and then this bright, pretty apple green. And I'm going to stamp with the violet, and then I'm going to come and I'm going to wash some color over that. And we talked a moment ago about how these paints can be thinned down to create a very transparent wash, and that's what I'm going to do. But first I'm going to stamp with the violet, and to do that, I'm just going to put a little bit out on my craft sheet here, and that's probably too much, and I'm going to bring in a stamp. Now you probably will recognize this, I've used this a lot lately, it's that Hero Arts Single Starburst. So I want to kind of spread this out because I don't want to glop the paint in any one spot there, and so I'm just going to stamp lightly in here, and then I'm going to stamp it off a little bit so that I have paint on here, but I don't have such globby amounts of color that it's really going to just make a blob rather than the impression. And obviously I didn't have quite enough here, so I want to pay attention, and I want to get this on. All right, that looks pretty good. So I'll go ahead and I'll stamp here, and there, I got a really nice impression that time. Because these paints are not thin and runny and very watery, and some water-based paints are, that's just the nature of them, it's really easy to stamp with them. You can see I'm getting nice, crisp impressions, and this is not difficult to do at all. So what I'm going to do is continue to stamp on here. I want to create some texture in my background, and then I want to wash some color over it. So I'm going to finish stamping, and then I'm going to dry this purple paint because it will be permanent once it's dry, which means when I wash these other colors over, I'm not going to compromise that at all. So I'm just going to wipe this up, get it out of the way so I don't end up getting into it by mistake. And obviously, I want to take care with this stamp. I'm going to mist it so that it's all wet, and then I'm going to set it face down over to the side. You can't see it, but I know that it's sitting in a little puddle of water, which is fine because that means that the paint's not going to dry on the rubber stamp. So I'm going to bring in my heat tool just for a moment. I want to make certain that these colors are dry. My stamped impressions are dry, and so now I'm going to bring in the apple green and the olive again, and I'm just going to wet my brush and put some water on here. It's got a little pink in it, but that doesn't matter. And I'm going to pick up a little bit of this apple green. And what I want to do is thin the paint down so I get a reasonably transparent wash. I'm still going to get color, and I'm going to get all of that lovely shimmer too, but it's going to be very transparent, and you can see how transparent that is. Isn't this cool though? Because I can get this color layered on here. I'm not going to change the purple at all, but I'm going to create a really interesting background that I can then come and layer other elements over if I want. All right, so let me just pick up a little bit of this olive now, and I'm gonna water that down too. It might have been a little bit too much. Put a little bit more paint in there. And now I'm gonna wash this in here. Now, because the apple green is not dry, I will get some blending, but I'm not going to touch that purple at all. It's there, it's permanent, it's a done deal, and I don't have to worry about it moving. And that's really the beauty of this. There are certainly occasions when you want to be able to lift your color to ghost or to move things around, but there certainly are times also when it's nice to know that what you've put down is permanent, and you can think about adding color or texture or whatever you want to do over the top, knowing full well that you're not going to change what's already there. I need a little bit more water and a little bit more paint, and then I can sort of finish this corner. I'm just going to brush mix a little bit here too. And if I think this is too dark, I'll bring in a little bit more water, and I can come back and I can thin this out a little bit. But this is a fairly forgiving technique. Until this is dry, the color is not going to go anywhere. And you can see that I'm getting this kind of nice mottled effect going on here, which again, sometimes with a background, all you want to do is get some color and texture on there so that you can play afterward and collage elements on, rubber stamp things on. There's all different kinds of things that you can do once your background is in place. Earlier when we talked about stamping with Maya Gold, I neglected to show you how easy it is to do on fabric, so I want to do that now before we move on to anything else. So this is just some smooth fabric. You don't want to try to use anything too coarse, and you don't want to try to use too fine a design. This is nice and solid for the most part, so it's going to work pretty well. I'm actually just going to use my finger. I'm going to put some of the paint out. Well, that's not quite enough. I'm going to put some of the paint out on my craft sheet. Just kind of spread it out so it's in a thin layer. This is basically what we did the last time. I mean, the process is the same. It's just a question of stamping it on a different surface. So again, I want to kind of tap in here till I get paint on the entire surface of the stamp. And if I think I've got too much, I can try to stamp it off and see how that looks. I'm thinking that looks pretty good. So all I want to do is just come in and press it firmly on this fabric, and you get a really nice impression. This is easy to do and very effective, and because the Maya Gold is permanent, it obviously is going to stay in place once this gets wet. So there's lots of other things we can do too, and I want to talk about some of them now, but let me just clean this up, and I want to spray my stamp. I'm going to put it aside in a puddle of water so that I know that it will be still wet when I come back to clean it up, and that paint won't have dried on the surface. And the next thing I want to show you is, again, because this dries permanently, this is just our confetti stencil that I very loosely pushed some of the violet color through. It's not perfect. In some places it's darker, in some places it's lighter. But what I really want to show you is how effective this is. I'm going to come in with, whoops, that's the wrong color. I'm going to come in with some Postbox Red and some Funky Fuchsia dilution sprays. I'm going to spray over here, and then I'll come back and I'll wipe the color off of the paint, and you'll see that the paint is not going to move and it will not pick up any of the color. So again, I'm just going to come in and put some light color on here. I got a funky sprayer that doesn't want to work. Come on, I know you can do it. All right, so let me come in and just roll this off. Now, I didn't get a lot of color on here. It's not really deep, but it's effective at least to show you what I'm discussing here, which is that now I have color all over this page, well, except for where I'm misspraying, but I digress. I have color all over here, but the paint has stayed because obviously it's permanent when it's dry, so I can do this really cool kind of effect. Things that you can't do with sprays alone, you can easily do with the paint and a combination of sprays. Now, having said that, something else that you can do, I know there's an open spread here someplace, something else that you can do is work with stencils. This is another very effective technique. I'm going to bring in, this is Margaret Applin's, I think it's called Flight. These are these wonderful stylized butterflies. Now I have three colors. I'm going to come back to the apple green and the violet and the olive again. And I'm just going to put them out here where you can see. And I'm going to slide this back toward me so that I have some room to show you what it is I want to do. Now I need another piece of paper towel because I have paint on my fingers. And all I'm going to do is I'm going to grab, try to keep my fingers a little bit clean. I'm going to grab my palette knife. And I'm going to put a little bit of each of these colors out on my nonstick craft sheet so that I have some to dip my cut and dry foam in, because that's what I'm going to use. So I have a piece of cut and dry foam for each color. If you don't want to use one for each color, you certainly don't have to. So I'm just going to start by tapping the cut and dry foam in the color till I get some on the foam. Obviously, again, if you have too much, it's going to bleed underneath the stencil and you won't get a nice crisp image. So I'm going to start by tapping the green through the openings in the stencil, and I think I'll do a couple of the butterflies because these are really nice. All right, I'll probably just turn this around and use the back side. I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to repeat that process with the olive color. I'm going to tap. Now, because my color is not dry, although it will dry reasonably quickly because I'm not putting a super heavy coat on, but because that color is not dry, I can get a little bit of blending going on, and that's good, but you also have to remember that if I come in with purple over the top of this and the green is not dry, I'm liable to get mud. So that's something that you do, of course, want to think about. All right, now I'm going to grab a clean piece of cut and dry foam now, and I'm going to tap into my purple here till I get some loaded on there. And now I'm going to come in, and I think I want to just catch the edges of this butterfly, maybe a little bit in the body, and then I want to catch the edges of the wings. Kind of do the same thing here, a little on the body, catch the edges of the wings. Now, I'm always not taking my time generally when I'm demoing on a video, simply because I don't want to have this last forever, but obviously the more care you take, the better your results will be, and that's something that you always want to bear in mind. But you can see how nicely this works. I get this great color because these are really dynamite colors. Now, I did go a little bit over here, but I've also got that wonderful shimmer that's going on in there. So, you know, working with a stencil and some cut and dry foam with these paints means that you can do pretty much anything. I want to finish today with a couple of different techniques. They're both quite different, but they're both very effective and a lot of fun to work with. I have an open spread in my journal. This is just a 3-inch square acrylic block that you would use to mount a cling stamp on. I have two colors of Maya Gold. I have apple green and olive. And I'm actually going to put the paint directly on this acrylic block with my palette knife. And I'm just going to kind of scooch this around. I don't want to blend this too much, because if I do, it won't show up as nicely, and you'll see in 1 second. Now, I'm just going to take my mister, and I'm going to turn to one side, and I'm going to give this a very light mist. And I don't know if you can see that, but there's a little bit of water droplets on there. Now what I'm going to do is I'm just going to take this and I'm going to stamp it and smush it. And how cool is that? You get this really interesting patterning going on that is totally random, that, you know, you probably could never reproduce, but creates some interesting background elements. So I can pick that back up and stamp again, because obviously there's a fair amount of paint there, and I can kind of spread this around. There's lots of different ways that you can work with this. Now, I could miss this page a little bit too, which would help these colors run, but these are not like distress paint. They are not immediately reactive with water, but I'm going to finish this up now on this other side, and then what I'll do is dry this and come back with some spritzes, you know, whatever they end up being, color wash or something, and I will put them on there, and that will fill in my color while giving me, you know, a more solid background. Let me miss this. While giving me a more solid background, and it will clear up some of this white space that I have on there, because I'm not fond of working on really white, light backgrounds. So I'm going to put a little bit more on here. Again, I'm just going to keep layering the color on. I'm not doing anything special. I'm not doing anything fancy. I want it to be as random as possible. I'm going to spritz off to the side again, and I'm going to come in and I'm going to mush this around here. And because I'm at the end of the journal, this doesn't want to lay totally flat for me, but that's all right. I can make it work. I'm going to come in up here. And now what I'm going to do is I'm just going to dry this, and then once it's dry, I'll come back and I'll show you how cool this looks once I start spritzing color on here. This is dry enough now that I can come back with my color wash and my dilutions and spray over it. And I think I'm going to use the same two colors I did the last time, which is Funky Fuchsia. And you can see how the liquid beads up on the paint. Again, it's going to act as that nice resist, so it's going to prohibit the color from adhering to the paper there. And I think I want this one a little bit more fuchsia, a little bit more postbox red than fuchsia, so I'm going to come in a little bit more heavily with that color. Now I'm just going to grab some paper towel and mop this up. And you can see, get this really interesting background going on here. This is, again, not anything that you could achieve unless you used some kind of a paint that was permanent so that we could get this color going on, because obviously the color is going to absorb into the paper. The color of the dilutions is going to absorb into the paper, but not where the paint is. So I think that this is also a really effective technique. Now I can layer things over here. I could stamp some elements and cut them out and collage them over the top. I can bring out my pit pens and I can draw some borders on here. Lots of fun things. So let me get that out of the way and bring in the last little bit. If you watched the distress paint video that I did, you'll remember that I picked up the bottle of paint, dauber side down, and I swirled some color on there, and I did that with multiple layers and drew some flowers over the top. Well, these colors are so nice that I wanted to try to approximate that, but obviously without a dabber top, I had to figure out something else that I could do instead. And what I came up with was one of these splodger things. I can't exactly remember what it's called, but, you know, they're made by Low Cornell, and they're just these sponges, and you can see that I've still got a little bit of purple paint in here. Now, this will have to be washed out, or this will get ruined, but because I'm in between colors here, I wanted to get the purple on and let that dry so I could show you the technique. So I'm going to put, this is Fire Red, which I'm going to put over the top, because there'll be a really nice contrast. Because this is dry, obviously, I'm not going to have to worry about, let me see, I just need to get a little bit out here. I'm not going to have to worry about the colors mixing, because that's not going to happen. So I'm going to come in and I'm going to very lightly load this spouncer, I think is what they call it, or something along those lines. I'm just going to kind of lightly load that with paint, and I can see how much I've got going on there. When I tap it down on what I've already got on this paper, I'm going to twist at the same time, and I'm also going to do this because I'm trying to duplicate that look that I was getting when I use the dabber tops, where I get that kind of streaky color. And this is not this exactly the same, but it's close, and I like the way that it looks. So once I get this color on here and I get it to dry, then I can come back and I'll doodle my flowers. Now, when I do this, if I'm working in between colors and I know that I'm going to apply more colors, and as it happens, I can only put my hands on one of these today. I have probably half a dozen, but I can't find them. So I've been working with just a single color. What I would do would be to just go ahead and push as much of that color out as possible before I move on to the next. So let me just take a moment to dry this. I'm dry now, and so in comes my black fine-tipped pit pen, and this is the Signo Uni Broad White Paint Pen. So what I'm going to do is start with my black pen, and I'm just going to very loosely draw some floral elements on here. Now, I do all different kinds of these when I do them. Sometimes they're little short petals, sometimes they're longer, but the one thing that they usually have in common is I like to put these big white dots in the center, and I like to put some smaller ones in too. So the way that I do that is I get this done with the black, and then I bring in the Unisigno pen, and I like to do just a little bit of, I gotta get the pen going, just a little bit of highlighting around here. So I add a little bit of dimension to these flower petals. And I'm not being careful to exactly trace what's on here. I just want to add a hint of that color. And then to get those white centers, I'm going to tap, tap, tap with my pen tip until I get that color flowing. And then I'm just going to let it flow out and fill in that space, kind of tapping the entire way. Now you can do this with all kinds of color combinations, so long as you let the first or second color dry before you add the next layer, then you won't get any mixing and you'll see discrete layers of color. But this is fun to do. I like to cut these out and I tend to use them on my journal pages. It's really easy to, you know, cut them out and put them on your pages, and then you can draw some simple stems. Lots of different ways that you can use this, and let me tip this so you can see it. Now again, this is kind of dark, so it might be a little hard to see, but I guess my point was is by using sort of an orange color and a purple, by letting it dry in between, I maintain those colors, I can see the layers, and I still get all of this fun swirl effect. It's not exactly the same as doing it with the dabber top, but it's a pretty close facsimile, and because these paints are so beautiful, I really like the idea of being able to use them in this way. You know, these Maya Gold paints are very, very pretty. The colors are lush, they're just full of shimmer, and they are really easy to work with. And I hope that you get a chance to try them too, because I think they're well worth having them in your studio.